Welcome to Magic TV. I'm Tristan Shaun Gregson here with Luis Scott-Vargas. We're not too far away from Worlds. There's a lot of Standard being played right now.
Yeah.
And so I came in today and I'm like, Luis, what's going on with Standard? What's really good?
Yeah. We decided to break it down to kind of the top eight cards that we feel represent Standard. I mean, obviously a lot of them key to individual decks, but some of them you see in multiple decks.
Where do we start?
Well, in no particular order, since we're just talking about the eight most influential cards, and although some are better than others, it's still kind of hard to order them. We'll go ahead and start with Goblin Guide, because I think Goblin Guide represents a whole segment of the population, which would be the aggressive red decks, obviously.
Decks with mountains in them.
Yes.
Well, not all of them, but a lot of them with mountains.
Well, the mono red deck and Boros are the two biggest decks that play Goblin Guide, and they kind of make up the aggro part of the format.
They definitely define one side of it, where you have to be prepared for that card.
Yeah. Them, along with elves, is pretty much the beatdowns. And Goblin Guide, you know, combined with Searing Blaze, Lightning Bolt, Step Lengths, whatever, from Mono Red or Boros, they make up an important part of Standard.
Would you put the Quest deck in that corner, or would it be somewhere else?
Quest is aggro combo. I mean, it's aggro, but it relies on this, you know, combo of Quest plus Guise or Stoneforge Mystic plus Core Outfitter plus Argentum Armor. So, I mean, obviously it doesn't have anything to do with the Goblin Guide particularly, but it is one of the aggro decks in the format.
Definitely Goblin Guide, right there, one of the eight cards.
Basically, if Lightning Bolt is good against your deck, you're an aggro deck.
Good answer.
So, moving on from Goblin Guide, we have, well, a pair of Titans, starting with Frost Titan, which has become one of the more popular finishers for blue decks, although it's getting to the point where it's not the only card that they consider. But Frost Titan has definitely shown up in blue-red, blue-white, blue-black, red, blue, green.
Blue.
Basically, blue, any combination of blue.
Blue something is going to want to play this.
You know, has Frosty the Snowman here to lock down his opponent's creatures.
He used to be the blue-headed stepchild, and now here he is ruling Standard.
Yeah.
I mean, you really said it all. A lot of the blue control decks can use this guy as a finisher effectively. And maybe he's not a four of, but maybe he's a two of with another guy. But he's very versatile. Yeah. He gets stuff done.
Well, he stops stuff as things as diverse as like Mimic Vat, stops Primeval Titan. Locks down, you know, any creature, and is also difficult to deal with. I mean, if they're short on mana, if you lock down one of their lands, they won't all be able to kill it.
Second green source, whatever it is, the blocker for you to get to their Jace or whatever.
Exactly. Moving on to the other Titan, Primeval Titan, which is, if there was to be a number one, he'd be pretty close. He's the linchpin of both Valakut and Eldrazi Green, and he's even shown up in other decks from time to time.
Yeah.
He is really powerful. There's a reason he's like the most valuable Titan. When he comes out, I mean, when he resolves, it's pretty difficult for you to win. Even if they kill him immediately, you still got pretty good value. Whether in Valakut, getting two Valakuts or a Valakut in a mountain in order to start triggering them, or whether in Eldrazi Green, getting, you know, Temple plus Eye of Ugin and all of a sudden threatening to Ulamog you to death.
Primeval Titan is obviously one of those very top cards, because it's one when you're playing with the deck with it, you're like, man, I hope I have it by turn five or six. Or when you're playing against
turn four,
it, you're always...
Turn four.
You're always like, not this turn. Anything to this turn. No, there it is, damn it. And then the whole game changes.
And if it was just Primeval Titan, it wouldn't be too bad. You can just mana leak him. But moving on to the next card, we've got Summoning Trap, which greatly impacts how the green decks fight against the blue decks. I think without Trap, the blue decks would be way more dominant. But the fact is, you can't just mana leak their Titan and, you know, be like,
You can't just mana leak anything. You can't mana leak that Oracle, that
Overgrown Battlement. I've seen turn two Titan, you know.
Yeah.
You mana leak their Battlement and then just trap you. Summoning Trap is a way to fight against Mana Leak and, to some lesser extent, Deprive and Stoic Rebuttal. It basically makes it so you get to play a card which hoses counterspells really well, but isn't dead. You can play main deck Summoning Traps because you can still just cast them. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're paying six mana for generally guys that cost six or more mana.
Yeah, it's one of those things where, and you know, it's like end of turn, kind of dramatic entrance effect, where it's like, all right, you're done. Now the green gets to kind of do something instant speed.
Right.
And it's like, oh, you countered that one? All right, I'll untap and play my guy.
Yeah. So either way, it fights against counters. Either go end of turn, untap, do it, or you just play your guy, they counter it, then you play. So either way, Summoning Trap is quite good.
So they're all rolling together here. We go from Summoning Trap into Mana Leak itself.
Yeah, Mana Leak is the card that Summoning Trap is built to fight against. But Mana Leak is kind of what makes the blue decks able to interact early to mid game, and even sometimes late game against the more expensive spells. I mean, you've got to, like, they've got to have ways to answer their opponent's threats, and this is one of the most versatile ways, because, you know, turns two through five, it counters almost anything, and later it can counter the expensive stuff. It gives you a two-mana card that can stop almost anything.
It really feels like it's the card that puts a lot of the blue decks in that top tier.
Yeah, I mean without Mana Leak, they would be just way more awkward.
Yeah, you could fight Goblin Guide, Summoning Trap, Primeval Titan, all with one card.
Well, Mana Leak's not too good against Goblin Guide.
Well, okay, not turn one, obviously, but they're going to play them to turns after that.
Right, turn four and then pay for your mana leak. But
that's fine. Spent the whole turn.
But no, mana leak, I mean, mana leak's still good against the red deck. You still get to mana leak their, you know, Koth or whatever. So I think mana leak is definitely one of the linchpins. And again, this is near the higher end of the cards that are important. It goes in many different decks and kind of just shapes how the whole format plays. Besides that, we've got Valakut, the Molten Pinnacle, which is only one card. It only shows up in one deck, obviously, because if you're playing Valakut in your deck, you know, you're a pretty dedicated Valakut.
You're a Valakut deck.
Every now and then a red deck plays one or two. It's like a mono red deck, but I'm more talking about the red-green Valakut deck. And the reason I mention it specifically is that it's one of the best decks in the format and one of the most dominant. It's very good against control and it, you know, a bunch of lightning bolts and early blockers, and you're actually decent against aggro too. So
yeah,
I think Valakut definitely shapes how other decks play, like whether they play Tectonic Edge or Spreading Seas is definitely a function of Valakut.
It's very interesting how a land in a red-green deck can have such an impact on a late-game matchup. Like this card that allows you to draw Mountain on turn 12, yeah, when you're out, and like all of a sudden you're doing something.
Yeah, all of a sudden, like, you know, you're like, well, I've got him unless he draws a Mountain or a green or a search card.
Yeah.
I hope he draws Calling Heart Expedition.
Yeah. Like, yes.
If you don't want them to draw a Mountain, you're drawing pretty slim against Valakut.
Bad times.
So moving on, we've got Abyssal Persecutor, which is another threat in mostly the blue-black decks, but is unique enough that I think it's worth mentioning because he also stresses other decks' creature removal because he's immune to so much of it. I mean, there's no Path to Exile anymore. That was one of his big drawbacks before.
And there's a lot of Doomblades in those yeah, X-black control,
I mean,
decks.
Look, the blue-red and blue-black have Doomblade and Lightning Bolt, and neither of those does really much against the Persecutor. And the blue-black deck has plenty of ways to get rid of them, too.
I think what's really key on this guy is that he is kind of like another Titan, because so much of the format is based around Titans right now. Here you have another 6/6.
He's a four-mana Titan.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is really the biggest deal. That's what makes him so good, in my
opinion.
He's
finally coming into his own. I mean, he was a pretty hyped card when it first came out, didn't do anything, and then by the time, you know, at this point, he's actually becoming a good card again. So, I think losing Path was the biggest thing.
Well, yeah, right. So, any. I mean, if we're playing with more 6/6s,
yeah,
if that's really where, you know, things are kind of going, we've already mentioned two, I think this guy really has a home. And the control deck, I mean, here you are, you're playing blue-black, and on turn 6, you can cast Frost Titan and maybe lock something down, or you can cast a 6/6 and still have Counter Magic up, or Doomblade up.
Or like, even some of the blue-black decks play Everflowing Chalice, and just going turn 2 Chalice, turn 3 Abyssal Persecutor, and you can kill them before their Primeval Titan does anything. And if you're on the play and they play a turn 4 Primeval Titan, they're almost dead by the time they do anything. So I think Abyssal Persecutor is definitely a card to watch. And of course, where would we be without Jace the Mind Sculptor?
Yeah, we left the big Jace in the room for last, obviously.
He shows up, again, all the blue decks basically play four of him. Sometimes they play three, but for the most part, it's four.
If you're playing three, usually you're playing some other Jace.
Like, true, Jace Bellerin.
Yeah.
But Jace the Mind Sculptor, he's not crushing the format as much as I thought he was going to, which I'm glad of. When Bloodbraid and Blightning rotated out and Maelstrom Pulse, I was like, man, Jace is just going to be unstoppable. But it turns out people, you know, build decks to take that into account. And even the ramp decks, which can't really interact with Jace that well early, Valakut and Eldrazi ramp just go over the top of Jace, which is difficult to do, but you can still do it by casting Embercool or Ulamog.
No, I mean, that's the whole,
you know, Titan up two Valakuts.
Yeah, that's the whole point of those turn four Titans, is like, the red-green deck doesn't have that many ways to stop him, where it's like, all right, fine, you're going to tap on turn four and play that guy, well, I'm going to go, over the top, big summon bigger.
I mean, normally a six drop that gets bounced by Jace is terrible, but if they bounce your Primeval Titan, you're more than fine with that. You just play it again and kill Jace with the Valakut triggers or whatever. So Jace is insane. Jace is still awesome, but Jace doesn't have a stranglehold on the format at this point, which is good. I think it's a little healthier for that to be the case.
A stranglehold is so close. I mean, he's everywhere, though.
But he doesn't feel as unfair as I thought he was going to. Again, like, the red decks can ignore him or just kill him easily. The ramp decks can go over the top. I mean, yeah, the control decks, when they fight, it's all about Jace. But, I mean, that's just how it is. So.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's fine. I mean, the game could be about
live
that.
By the Jace, die by the Jace. But when it's Jace versus not Jace, it's actually not as lopsided as I thought. Which, I think is good. I think Jace shouldn't be able to just kill everything and, you know, be the best card ever. It's still pretty good, but a Jace is definitely beatable now. So there you have our kind of snapshot of Standard with our top 8 cards. I don't know. Let us know if we missed anything. I'm sure plenty of people think
we
did.
Didn't mention a white card. Or even an artifact, for that matter.
If white cards were good, we'd mention them.
Wow.
We talked about Quest a little bit.
We talked about it being a card that existed. We didn't really say it was good.
If you look at the best decks, there are the ramp decks, the control decks, and the aggressive red decks. I mean, there's slight room in there for elves and white decks, but I think these decks are better.
There's some Mox Opals out there. There's some Mimic Vats out there. There's some Worm Coil Engines out there. Let's not forget about Scars.
They're just not deck-defining enough. So.
Okay.
Well, I guess, yeah, that'll do it for now. And again, feel free to let us know what we missed and... Or just tell us you agree with us, because that's much better.
I guess.
Thanks for watching.